Good morning once again. Good greetings of the day. Good greetings of this conference. And it's a great pleasure to be welcoming all of you on behalf of RICS to the conference, which is on the topic, on the theme, Turning Point for the Built Environment, brought to you by Tata Housing. And at the very outset, let me also take this opportunity of introducing myself to all of you. Myself, Vimi Chaudhary, I'm the facilitator, the moderator of the inaugural session. And would just like to take a few minutes of yours to set the context of our discussions and deliberations, and then we are going to be presenting to you from the leaders of RICS, the RICS point of view. Now, if we actually see the developments which we have seen in our country in the recent few days, especially the two surgical strikes, it becomes very clear that India is all set to carve out a new and a very different growth story for itself. A growth story which is on a very strong foundation of transparency, accountability, ethics, clean governance, bringing in healthy competition, ready to take center stage on the global map, and at the same time, driving in skills, speed, scale, quality, infrastructure, standards, so that in a very smooth and yes, a very planned and a sustainable manner, we are able to transcend from being a developing economy to a developed economy. And if you see, never before we have witnessed that the will and the aspirations of the government are in line on the same page as the will and the aspirations of the citizens of this country. And that's going to be the turning point for this nation and a turning point which every sector needs also to concentrate. We are slowly moving from being an unorganized economy to an organized economy. So in the wake of all these changes which we are witnessing, whether it is the policy, the regulatory, the economic, the infrastructure changes which we are going to be seeing, smart cities coming up, and then the technological advancements. We're already in the tech world of IoT, Internet of Things, Big Data, SMAC, the smart mobility analytics and cloud computing. And all this is going to be impacting every sector. And thereby, it becomes extremely, extremely pertinent for the built environment, for the built world, to evolve itself, to adapt itself to these changes, to be more responsible and more responsive to this growing economy, for it definitely forms and lays a strong foundation for this growing, progressive economy of our country. So in this day-long discussions and deliberations, we are going to be looking into these changes and the impact which these changes are going to be having on the Indian built environment. And as we do so, we are really glad that we have the experts, we have the professionals, the think tanks present with us who are going to be bringing in their views and help this industry take more decisive decisions, more informed decisions, more intelligent decisions towards this evolution and transformation which we are talking about. And herein, we feel that RICS plays a very important role. Now, many of you might be aware that RICS was established way back in the year 1868 as per the Royal Charter. And since then, in fact, it has been promoting, in fact, it also has been enforcing the chartered qualifications and the standards in the land, real estate, infrastructure, and the construction space so as to create a more safe and a very vibrant marketplace through a strict code of ethics. RICS India was established just 8 years back, so it's been a good years of eight journey, taking this vision and mission of RICS Global here in India. So it's been a journey where we have accomplished something. We are definitely looking forward to taking this vision forward and mission forward. So to let you talk about this entire journey and also to present his own views, I would like to invite here the Global Managing Director of Emerging Business RICS, Mr. Sachin Sindhi. So please, ladies and gentlemen, a big hand for him as I invite him for his welcome address and also his views.
Honorable Minister for Railways, Mr. Suresh Prabhu, Ms. Amanda Clark, President, RICS, Dr. Sean Tompkins, Chief Executive, RICS, Dr. Aseem Chauhan, Chancellor, Amity University, Mumbai, Mr. Anshuman Magazine, Chairman and Chairman India and Southeast Asia, CBRE, and also the Chairman of the South Asia Board for RICS, friends from the industry and media, respected ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to welcome you to this RICS conference on Turning Point in Built Environment in the Perform or Perish Economy. Some months ago, when we were thinking about the conference theme, it seemed like important reforms and schemes like the Real Estate Regulation Authority, the GST, REITs, 100 Smart Cities, Housing for All, etc., were going to bring about the industry to a turning point. From the current standpoint, the theme couldn't have been more apt, as it is truly a turning point, not just for the industry, but for the country. Prime Minister's master stroke of demonetizing Rs 500 and Rs 1,000 notes will change the face of India's corruption and parallel economy and the black money market in India. RICS, as you know, has been campaigning for increased transparency in the sector. We are happy with this bold measure intended to curb black money. The impact of demonetization will be far-reaching on the real estate sector. It is a well-known fact that a large share of unaccounted wealth in the country is invested in the property market. In the secondary market, there are many transactions that are unaccounted for. Demonetization will put an end to this. This move, along with RERA, will go a long way in improving the image of the sector and improving transparency. It has been a roller coaster ride for the sector the last 2 years. We've had our share of highs and lows. On the one side, there was optimism with the government's announcements of 100 smart cities and housing for all, rejuvenating existing 500 cities initiatives. On the other hand, there's been a lot of pain due to the stagnant market and capital crunch. There's been a lot of noise over delay in projects. The Honorable Supreme Court has come down heavily on some developers with delayed projects, asking them to refund principal cost of flats to buyers. The ones who didn't comply were even sent to judicial custody. The government is also doing its bit to clean up the industry and bringing in regulation. The Honorable Supreme Court underlined this when it said, the foundation of the economy is faith, and if faith is lost, everything is lost. The message to the industry from all quarters is quite clear, shape up or ship out. I think you may have seen the news of independent directors resigning from the boards of real estate developers fearing trouble ahead for them in case the company does not comply with the RERA regulations. It has also been reported that private equity funds and investors in the sector are renegotiating their contracts with developers so that they do not get labeled as developers and end up facing punishment for violation of rules in projects they fund. The lows have received a lot of attention, and we are now perhaps at our lowest ebb. We would have to go back to the drawing board and start from ground zero. There will be plenty of pain in the sector for some time to come, although the long-term outlook for the sector is bright, and things are bound to get better with all the positive reforms and transparency measures. The conference theme today, the Turning Point in Built Environment, seeks to have a very focused debate on what we think are the most important areas that will shape the direction of the industry henceforth. Government-led reforms of GST and real estate regulation, as you all know, will have a significant impact, though the exact nature of the impact, good or bad, is yet uncertain. We have tried to decode what these reforms could mean for the sector through a white paper which will be unveiled in the session later today. There are some interesting and debatable arguments, and I'm looking forward to hearing expert panel's views. Also, with new cities coming up and existing cities getting rejuvenated, how do we plan for new areas to be developed around routes that support mass transit, rail or bus-based, is very important. We are already witnessing extensive urban sprawl along with ever-increasing ownership of vehicles, resulting in high congestion and impacted movement on streets. We have also varied points on whether construction of flyovers is going to solve or create further livability issues. We have invited experts who have a first-hand experience of such projects, and it would be useful to really understand what transit-oriented development means for India. We thought that property technology would be a very fascinating session as well, as maybe not as up-to-date on where technology is taking the sector or has the potential to. Virtual walkthroughs of projects, 360-degree views of interior spaces, 3D rendered models that can be viewed with a virtual reality headset have made it easier to market real estate projects online. These tools are bringing in more transparency in online real estate transactions. How is the tech startup space going to evolve? Will we see consolidation and foreign investment in these? What type of skill sets and data management capabilities need to be built amongst professionals as well as young talent that needs to be attracted to this sector and embrace technology? All these and more aspects will be discussed in the sessions on PropTech. Being a professional body, developing future talent, shaping leadership are close to our heart. No conference of ours would be complete without due discussion on this important but boring to some topic. The war for talent is only rising, with businesses finding it hard to train and equally hard to retain talent. Given the kind of ambitious projects India is undertaking now and in the future, the role of qualified professionals cannot be emphasized enough. We've kept this as the last but most important session of the day, as top leaders in the sector come together to debate on how this sector can attract bright talent right after school, whether the sector needs talent from other industries, how can we invest to develop our people to the best in their field and emerge as strong leaders. Most global organizations, including RICS, are making a concerted effort to attract women in the sector. SBE specifically has made a small progress in growth of female students, which is encouraging. And support of organizations like Tata Housing and Mahindra Life Spaces is much appreciated. So these are some of the themes that we will discuss today. But today is special for RICS in many ways. We will take the occasion to celebrate RICS' eight-year journey of creating professionalism in India. RICS was set up in late 2008, right after the Lehman Brothers collapse, and the global market was reeling under the subprime lending crisis, ripples of which were felt in India. It wasn't the best time to have entered the country, but we felt that when the chips are down, people tend to reflect and realize the importance of professional standards that help in financial market stability. And so we made humble beginnings in our journey with fewer professionals, small number of training workshops. We've come a long way, and my hair has certainly grayed a bit in this time. Despite there being no statutory reason for being a member of the RICS or to be a member of a professional body, we have had over 30,000 professionals who have demanded the RICS qualification over the last 8 years, demonstrating that even in India, people aspire for the chartered status that helps provide confidence to the market, including lenders, corporate occupiers, foreign institutional investors, and the like. Such is the strength and the recognition of the RICS brand that even in this market, and today we have close to 3,000 members in the South Asia region. The challenge in India was that unlike other markets where we have RICS accredited courses, such courses are available in international markets and a prerequisite for the RICS qualification, which are offered by top universities. We did not have such courses that RICS could accredit in India. While civil engineering and architecture are well-developed professions, there's been very little development of other professions, other skills that are required in this profession. Without the development of the profession at the bachelor's and master's level courses, it was difficult to envisage how candidates could become chartered. Our first big phase of growth came the day we decided to launch a full-fledged school that provides a solid foundation of knowledge, which then leads to chartered qualification. The fact that India was facing a severe skills crisis was not unknown. But we did try to quantify the magnitude of the shortage at that time, which neared 80% or so. The strong call of my colleagues and friends was that if we had to make a difference in the Indian real estate market, we had to walk the talk. And hence, RICS took the historic step of establishing an educational institution. I have to thank Dr. Asim Chauhan, Dr. Atul Chauhan, and Dr. Ashok Chauhan for being the perfect partners for us in the country in this journey. The school completed 3 years in April 2006, and it's with huge pride that I share that we have close to 1,500 full-time students studying undergraduate and postgraduate programs. Two batches have passed out with 100% placements at significant compensation levels. Average domestic salaries have been about 7.25 lakhs per annum, and average international salaries have been about 19 lakhs per annum. Since these courses are RICS accredited, and these are the only RICS accredited courses in India, they will not only serve to the entry-level manpower needs of the industry, but over a period of time will make our students eligible to achieve the MRICS status. After a minimum of 2 years professional experience, these students can come forward to qualify through their assessment of professional competence and become members of the RICS. In this manner, we endeavor to create a much wider pool of chartered professionals, the five letters which denote market confidence, which will go a long way in improving the delivery capabilities of the industry and by creating professionalism in the industry. The other area in which we've already scaled up significantly is training and learning and development solutions for the industry. Today, we train nearly 5,000 professionals per year across different formats in India, and we aim to increase this to 50,000 professionals per year in the next 5 to 7 years. At this point of time, we are the training partner of choice for a whole number of developers, contractors, consultants and lenders, including companies like L&T, Mahindra Lifespaces, K. Raheja Corp and public sector clients like NBCC. Today is very special for the RICS as we will formally launch our second campus in the presence of our global CEO and global president and the Chancellor of Amity University, Mumbai, Aseem Chauhan. Over the last few years, RICS as a public interest body has also contributed to many public consultations and has been a part of select committees and has worked with various government ministries on policy initiatives, the most recent of which was to chair the subcommittee for valuations, valuation norms for REITs and InvITs. Our efforts with the National Housing Bank, the Indian Banks Association, and the Department of Financial Services, Ministry of Finance, Government of India, to standardize procedures for valuation of assets has already resulted in recognition of the RICS qualification and standards for valuations for banks. Given its public interest mandate, embedding standards in professional practices at the heart of what the RICS does, we are working on a number of areas to bring in standardization in India, including valuations, international property measurement standards, international construction measurement standards, and international ethics standards. We are also working on multiple forward-looking solutions, including emerging construction technologies, including building information modeling, prop tech, that will serve the needs of the real estate and construction industry of the future. With RERA, REITs, and GST just around the corner, it is time for the industry to raise the bar, improve standards, transparency, and corporate governance, many of which will become a necessary requirement. Adoption of international standards is inevitable as real estate trade and flow of money becomes cross-border, and international investors ask for financial reporting in the same language that they are used to seeing in their markets. Sean will throw further light on the importance of international standards. I'm certain that this industry will have to move towards being professional, and qualification norms and standards will become part of the regulatory requirements in the future. I would now like to take the opportunity to show a small AV reflecting our journey of the past and future. We've tried to take small steps in these 8 years. I now call on my industry friends and colleagues to join RICS in restoring trust, confidence, and respect in our sector. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. So that, ladies and gentlemen, is the vision and mission of RICS. The seeds of change already sown with the first school. We're taking this forward. And as said, these are small steps, but they're going to be making a huge impact. And now I would like to invite our distinguished guest speakers of the inaugural session as they bring in their point of view. So please join me as I invite here on the stage Ms. Amanda Clark, the President, RICS, and Partner and Head Infrastructure, ENY. Dr. Sean Tompkins, the Global CEO of RICS. Mr. Anshuman Magazine, the Chairman, RICS, South Asia Board and Chairman, India and Southeast Asia, CBRE. Dr. Aseem Chauhan, the Chancellor, Amity University. And Mr. Sachin Sandhir, the Global Managing Director, Emerging Business, RICS. And ladies and gentlemen, I think all of you will agree that the flowers with their freshness and their colors, they definitely communicate a message of a hearty welcome, which we would like to extend to our distinguished speakers here. So I would like to request Mr. Sachin Sandhir to please accord a floral welcome to our distinguished guest speakers. And please join us as we extend these greetings once again to Ms. Amanda Clark, to Dr. Sean Tompkins, to Dr. Aseem Chauhan. Okay, anyway, we go in this order. And to Mr. Anshuman Magazine. Thank you. And at the very outset now, we try to get the views of our guest speakers. And first, views on the RICS vision to deliver confidence through international standards. For the same, I would like to now first request Dr. Sean Tompkins, the Global CEO, RICS, for his keynote address on this topic.
Well, good morning, everybody. And thank you very much for being here on a holiday. It's pretty impressive. So thank you very much for doing that. It's really lovely to see so many friends and familiar faces. Our fantastic RICS staff, professionally qualified members of RICS, members of our governing body, our board, and our wonderful partners in education at Amity. The first thing I have is that clearly, in recalling you all as being friends, clearly we've been here and there in India for about 4 or 5 days. So as friends, I have a special request. Does anyone have any change? Yeah? You know, I've been struggling since I've been here, so apologies. Mark Powell and I, unfortunately, about 12 hours before the announcement from your Prime Minister Modi, we transferred pounds into rupees. So we have many 1,500 notes. So that was a beginning for us here. And but look, good morning. And I think for me, this is a real opportunity to sort of plot a little bit of a journey since 2009, when I first started coming to India, and in 2008 when I first met Sachin. Absolutely, India is without a doubt on a growth story, and RICS really recognizes that. And that growth story is about transparency. That growth story is about opening up to foreign direct investment. It is about skills. It is about standards. And RICS has had all of those at our heart since 1868. So I think RICS and India's are really brothers and sisters in this journey that I think will transform the built environment within India. And we are absolutely committed to being partners on that journey for a long period of time. I met a number of years ago in London on the terrace of our RICS headquarters, Kamal Nath, who was the Minister of Urban Development at the time. And we performed a piece of research for Kamal Nath on skills development and skills requirements in India. And I remember him saying to me that, look, India has no real fiscal issues here in terms of what we need to achieve within the built environment. We've just got a massive skills shortage in needing this transformation. Many millions shortage in terms of engineers, in terms of architects, in terms of surveyors. And at the time, we calculated that if the population of India continued as it is, if the urban development story of India continued as it was, without any real dramatic rises in population, then India needs to be capable of building a city the size of Chicago every year for the next 26 years. That requires a serious level of change in an industry. It requires completely new mindsets and completely new skills. And that's without considering the fact that actually, if we continue building at the rate we're building, we'll require two planets come 2050 just to help us with the resources. So RICS is a professional body. At our heart, we have a royal charter. We take that royal charter with huge pride. Everybody who carries our qualification carries the brand of this profession. So we are as strong as the weakest individual within our profession. And therefore, it is absolutely essential that everybody works to those high standards, ethical principles, because they contribute value in this profession to 180,000 people in the world. We actually have 125,000 people who are professionally qualified, who hold our professional qualifications, FRICS, Fellow, MRICS, Member, ASOC RICS, Associate, and we have 60,000 students and trainees looking to become RICS qualified around the world. We have offices in all of the major political and financial centres of the world. Now, many of you have seen many of the things RICS does, but we educate, we train, we grant a professional status. And when we grant those professional letters, we are granting our royal charter to that individual. We set ethical standards, we set professional standards, we create knowledge that we can share around the world, we build networks that people can use to expand their knowledge, to expand their research, to connect for friendships, to connect for business environments, and we advise policymakers in society's interests. Not in our own self-interests, but what we think is the right thing for governments to do to advance society. Recently, we've taken on a bigger remit as a professional body. We have set up coalitions of professional bodies all around the world to lead on creating standards that the market can absolutely have confidence in, all the way from London to Delhi, from Mumbai to Sydney, you know, from Dubai all the way to New York. That those standards are absolutely consistent, that people will understand what they mean. And it is quite incredible that in a very mature market of real estate, you cannot go to a country in the world that measures its real estate in the same way. Today, if I took exactly the same building, moved it from New Delhi to the USA, moved it from the USA to Athens, moved it from Athens to Sydney, the size of that building will vary by up to 24%. That is not a consistent professional market where investors will have high confidence in the expertise. So we have set about building international property measurement standards in residential, in offices, in warehousing, in retail, and we will be bringing all of those standards together all around the world. So any market that truly wants to operate to international standards can take those standards and incorporate it in its best practice. We also have international construction measurement standards. I think all of us know that in construction projects, we all use variable terminology, different descriptors, which all bring issues of risk into the way in which construction projects work. Very difficult to compare data. We don't actually know how much things cost. So we are working on international construction measurement standards that will start to bring consistency into the risk management within construction. We're also working on international ethical standards. We think that the built environment needs to embrace a whole new standard globally in terms of the ethics with how it works. And we have a whole coalition now of organisations from all around the world working to produce a single set of what we think are the expected ethical standards in the built environment. Clearly, we're also well known as an organisation for what we do in the world of valuation. Valuation underpins the financial systems of the world, as we saw in the financial crisis, and its alignment back to real estate. RICS is an active partner of the International Valuation Standards Council. We produce the world-renowned Red Book of Valuation. We have registered valuers in every country of the world, and we are leading the way on embedding and setting the standards for valuation practice. But we also go further as an organisation. Setting standards and qualifying professionals is very, very important. But also, we have a big role to play on the world stage. The built environment is absolutely essential for the future of generations to come. And we take that responsibility really seriously. And I think here in India, it's really interesting. When I first came here in 2008, I think Sachin said to me, you know, what's going to be one of our biggest challenges in developing this profession? He said, well, we're going to have to convince grandparents and parents that sending their children to develop themselves in a profession in real estate and construction is actually something meaningful, because it's not considered a profession today. But actually, if you think about everything that's happening in the world, the built environment is going to be probably one of the most important professions that next generations will need. And let me give you an example of that. I was in Paris for COP21. We were the only professional body around the world invited to speak with governments on the Global Buildings Alliance. This is basically looking at how we build and looking at what it's going to mean for generations in the future. Just to give you a few statistics that I think show you how important this profession is to the future of our children and their children. Buildings emit 40% of the world's carbon. So when they're being built and when they're being used, they're using 40%, or emitting 40% of the world's carbon. If we continue the rate of expansion that we need in our urban environment, smart cities, you know, mega cities within China, refurbishment and renewal of cities in Western Europe, we have some real challenges ahead of us. We need to be able to do this in a much smarter way. We need to embrace technology, new ways of construction, because we can't continue at that pace. Secondly, buildings use 30% of the world's water. Just think about it. In use, in construction, in use, they're using 30% of the world's water, and they use 40% of the world's energy. So we need some serious new thinking. Put that into perspective. In 1900, there were 3 billion people on the planet. Come 2050, there will be 9 billion. I can promise you now that professionals in the built environment will be absolutely essential for our children and their children's children. We sadly don't have the luxury yet of two planets to be able to continue in the way that we are. We also have set up something called the World Built Environment Forum, where we bring together the leading experts from across the globe to look at some of the big issues that exist in the built environment. We think the built environment needs its own world forum where those experts can come together and share thinking. So we're looking at leading on a number of issues around sustainability, infrastructure, prop tech, big data, disruption, energy efficiency, diversity and inclusion, because actually that's critical. A more diverse profession. Given everything's going to happen, we are going to be in a war for talented individuals and attracting them into the built environment. In 2016, we had our World Built Environment Forum in Washington, D.C. In 2017, we will be holding it in Shanghai. In 2018, we will be holding it in London. You're all welcome to Shanghai. You're all welcome to London. 2018 will be the 150th anniversary of RICS holding its Royal Charter. And in 2019, could it be India? Could we be bringing the World Built Environment Forum here to India? Sachin, opportunity to start bidding. So our work here in India is absolutely real. We are educating and we are qualifying the future of India's land, real estate, infrastructure, and construction talent. Our partnership with Amity started off in Noida. It's a tremendous partnership. As Sachin said, over 1,500 students now going through that program. I was at the convocation in Delhi last week. It was unbelievable experience to see so many bright young people coming into this industry who will be literally reshaping, rebuilding, and building India for generations to come. We had 170 graduates in our second convocation. 100% of them had placements in industry. And as Sachin said, 30% of those people were attracted outside of India. Big challenge, India. How do you attract and retain some of the incredible built environment professionals? Because the world has got built environment challenges as well. I think it's a big challenge in looking after those generations. So I'm absolutely delighted to be here. I think that RICS, as I say, is a massive partner to India in terms of the challenges, but the great opportunities you have as you continue to urbanize, develop smart cities, but importantly, you build the talent that's going to be required. I'm delighted to be part of educating, professionalizing real estate infrastructure and construction in India. I think everything I've heard over the last week, all of the television programs that I've watched, all has an absolutely requirement for something new, something fresh, something that's right for future generations. And I'm delighted that RICS is going to be part of it. So the young individuals we are going to be helping today in Noida, in Mumbai, and hopefully in time in Bangalore are going to be the future builders and shapers of India. And I'm absolutely delighted as Global Chief Executive of RICS to be with you on that journey. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Tompkins, for bringing in your views on the vision and mission which RICS Global has and how it is translating here in India with RICS India, not only addressing the skill challenge or the skill crunch which India faces, and as you said, that we have a huge young demographic dividend. If we do not equip them with the right kind of skills and make them professionals, then instead of looking into being a part of the global economy, we might perish on just being in line of the falling empires. So that is where the importance of skills lie. And then you also mentioned about being responsive to the planet, to the growing challenges which the planet have, where we have the water crunch, we have the problem of the energy. That is where once we have professionals, people who are educated in this field, are going to be able to add more value to the profession of the built environment. So thank you so very much for bringing in these views and the importance of skills and standards in our business. And as we are talking about being on the global stage, it becomes again imperative to understand the key trends which are impacting the global built environment. We have a keynote address towards it, and I would like to request and invite here Ms. Amanda Clack, the President RICS and Partner in Head Infrastructure, ENY.
Honourable Minister for Railways, honourable guests, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for a warm welcome to India. It's been fantastic to spend some time over the last few days, both in Delhi at the convocation, as Sean said, but also to come to here in Mumbai and look at the absolute ambition around the School for the Built Environment. Coupled, of course, with meetings with ministers and also key stakeholders and employers from around India. I've been asked to talk to you about the key trends impacting the global built environment. And today I have just 10 minutes to do that. So there's quite a lot to cover in my 30 years of experience in the sector. but also just since becoming president in July, it's worth just sharing with you the journey that I've taken, quite literally Japan, Singapore, France, Hong Kong, China, Germany, Brazil, UK, and of course my very special visit to India. A truly special visit because it was great to be here 3 years ago and to actually see the journey that we've been on with Amity and the School of the Built Environment. But it was actually my work with RICS Futures, Our Changing World, Let's Be Ready, that looked to where the world is going to be in 2030 that helped shape my themes for this year as your president. Infrastructure, cities, and the war for talent. The scale of change in the world is enormous. It affects every country, whether emerging or developed. And we've seen some changes just since the 1st of July. UK's Brexit, Brazil's impeachment, the US presidential election, and of course here in India, Modi money. So the one thing that I can predict is that we're in a period of change. And today, the global population, in terms of living in our cities, is at 54%. But as Sean said, in 2050, the prediction is that with 9 billion people, 66% of those people will be living in cities just like this one. And with 65.5 million Indians already living in urban slums and sprawls, rapid urbanization is both an opportunity and an immense challenge for professionals in the built environment. Cities are taking on ever greater importance. They are our most enduring and stable social structures. They have become the world's dominant demographic and economic groupings. India is the second world's most populous city after Tokyo, with a registered population of 18.6 million people. The region is larger than that of Australia. And China's urban Chongqing region is an area the size of Austria. The mega cities of the future will be larger than many nations that we know today. Cities will literally be taking on nations. China is planning two mega cities of 100 million people. 13 out of 14 of the world's new mega cities will be in China. We have to think, what does that mean for our own countries and our own nations? Because the competition for foreign capital into our cities will grow. Success is no longer purely about size, and to attract those investors requires visionary leadership, good governance, and political and economic stability. Aspects such as innovation, livability, and an ability to transform and adapt changing social economic landscapes are becoming increasingly important. And in this environment, the role of real estate is incredibly important. In fact, it's vital. It can boost cities by providing the environment to provide creativity and also innovation. But real estate needs to provide a sense of community and well-being for our citizens. Otherwise, rapid urbanization is not sustainable. We need to have cities for citizens. The industry is shifting from simply housing businesses and people to attracting corporations into our major cities. And what about infrastructure? It's vital to delivering sustainable growth in our growing cities. It's the connectivity between cities and provides the movability within them. It's the cohesive glue of mobility and environmental fusion. The need to build new infrastructure and replace new assets is glaringly obvious, and yet matching funds to projects and supplying those professionals with the right skills remains a key challenge. But this challenge has a big opportunity for our professionals. We can establish ourselves as a leading voice in the sector. Through our research, like the RICS the Hub and the Place report, where we're already thinking of the role of infrastructure hubs in placemaking. As has been outlined, standards are absolutely key. So whether it's international land standards, international property measurement standards, international construction measurement standards, or of course, international ethics standards. But it's international construction measurement standards that have the potential to make a real impact on the sector. We launched the public consultation from London just last week. But with 30 organisations from around the world, not-for-profit organisations and professional organisations coming together to bring the best leading practice of standard making. They will help to standardise benchmarking, measuring and reporting of construction project costs. This provides certainty. Certainty attracts investors, essential in providing greater cost certainty and deliverability in our new developments and our new infrastructure. We also need to be bold in terms of embracing new technologies, for their impact will be huge and the pace of change rapid. The technological change in our industry may well be disruptive and removing some jobs altogether, but it can also provide huge opportunities. For instance, 3D printing could improve efficiency, reducing construction time and waste. It can improve transportation and pollution, improve our measures on sustainability, and the capability to print parts on site could see benefits flow to facilities and property management as well. Prefabrication and off-site building have the potential to be cheaper, more efficient and sustainable, and the role of BIM in taking us through improved design and construction through to facilities management and also asset management. And buildings are getting smarter too, from solar technology and renewables to smart meters, and smart buildings will prove crucial in maintaining that quality of life in a time of rapid urbanisation and dwindling resources. To deliver this ambition, of course, we need to tackle that war for talent. New skills are required to help the professionals of the future navigate these changes. Innovation needs to become a major driver of efficiency and productivity through to 2030. Skills are key for land, property construction and infrastructure. And here in India, we need to build professional capabilities through the School of the Built Environment and the RICS professional qualification to literally help build India's future. In addition, the property and construction profession desperately needs to attract a broader sense of entrance. We all know that the profession is facing a major skills crisis. This means that we need to embrace diversity and inclusion, and the need to do so has never been greater. It's the number one thing from our futures report that employers were telling us that they were most concerned about. How do we attract that talent and retain it for the future? So creating a truly diverse and inclusive profession is about giving everyone the opportunity to choose their path. There's no quick fix to rebalancing diversity within our profession, where our professionals are far from representative of society as a whole. It will take a combined effort of all of us, business, government, and individuals. As a profession, we need to have publicly visible role models that shows that all talented people from around the world, regardless of their background or identity, can thrive in this profession and within this industry. We've been encouraging this through Surveying the Future, a diversity programme, as well as recently launching a mentoring pilot, initially between ladies in South Africa and the UK, but hopefully to be rolled out across the world. So in conclusion, the scale of the change in the world today is enormous, and it affects every country, whether emerging or developed. I would just like to take a moment to thank the RICS staff team for all of their work that they put in. And I have to say that video that Sachin played at the start there was truly inspirational. So I personally am really looking forward to today and seeing how Indian real estate, construction and infrastructure can take advantage of these challenges. The growing credibility and transparency in the sector and the leadership that of RICS will push organisations to perform better in order to thrive in our changing world. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for bringing in your views on these key trends which are shaping the industry. In fact, as you mentioned, from Trump to Brexit to Modernization, all impacting the world, our professions. And with the, again, with these leaderships, with the aspirations of the global citizens, we are seeing a change. We are seeing the need to have communities and to build cities which bring in a sense of community, which bring in a sense of well-being, and you said. And that is where the role of RICS becomes very important in driving in standards, which is going to be ensuring quality, driving in technology, which is going to be ensuring pace, at the same time, smartness in our work, driving in talent, which is going to be bringing in innovation and people who understand these challenges. So thank you very much for your views. And as you've heard it also, RICS has been playing a very important role towards capacity building, having the right kind of people, extending them skills, making them professionals, helping them take more informed decisions in their work. And towards that, we already have the RICS School of Built Environment in Noida. As you heard, it was established some 3 years back. And now we have another milestone which we are going to be covering. This is a partnership which is with Amity University, wherein we look into more of the industry and the academia partnership to address these challenges. So we're really glad that we have Dr. Aseem Chauhan present with us, the Chancellor of Amity University present with us. And I would like to now request him to talk more about this industry-academia partnership and as we take it further forward. Thank you.
President of RICS, Ms. Amanda Clack, Dr. Sean Tompkins, who mentioned that he had been at the Amity convocation a few days ago, but he failed to mention that we were so pleased during that convocation to confer upon him an honorary doctorate, making him thereby officially a member of the Amity family. Mr. Mark Powell, dynamic leader Sachin Sandhir, Ms. Anshuman Magazine, one of the tallest thought leaders of the real estate industry in India, distinguished leaders of the real estate and urban infrastructure industry in India in the audience, Dr. Kole and the team of Amity University here in Mumbai, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, let me express how proud we are at Amity to be partnering with RICS, the most prestigious professional body in the world, looking at the real estate industry, on creating a new paradigm on education, on competency development, and skill development. In my belief, it is a truly pioneering exercise, not only in the Indian context, but maybe in the whole world, to have a professional body and a university come together and take such a broad view on what we can together do in close collaboration to create a new generation of leaders for a particular sector. Let me assure you, Ms. Amanda Clack and Dr. Sean Tompkins, that we at Amity are fully committed to this partnership and we're excited about the prospects that lie ahead of us where we are today. Today we are launching, as has been mentioned, the RICS School of Built Environment here in Mumbai after 3 years of successful implementation at our Amity University in Noida. In any partnership, when you have taken the first step together, and then you decide that we must expand our partnership and add locations, it means that there has been great success. And I'm sure that at the Amity University in Mumbai also, that this pioneering initiative will find the same success, if not more success, than what we have already seen at the Amit University in Noida. In fact, if I may say, pioneering initiatives here at this university in Mumbai is part of its DNA. A few years ago, Amit University here became the first private university of Maharashtra, which means that for the first time in its history, the State Assembly of Maharashtra passed a legislation, thereby enacting the university. And tomorrow, I can envision that there will be dozens of private universities, but the first step was taken by Amit University. And I think today's step of launching the School of Built Environment of RICS as part of this university is another step in the direction of creating new models of how education can be done. And we are so proud of this announcement here today. Ladies and gentlemen, as has been mentioned by my colleagues on the dais, we stand today at a very exciting juncture in India. By any measure and by any prediction, we can expect great economic development in the years to come. This is driven by a visionary and firm leadership that has shown commitment to expanding the infrastructure of the country, may it be highways or bridges or airports or ports or smart cities. At the same time, we have a vast young population, maybe the youngest in the world, and this young population has great aspirations to create a better future for themselves and for their families. This is, as has been mentioned, also being termed as the demographic dividend for a number of years now. But we also have to realize that unless we can provide the right skills, training, and education, the right skills and competencies to this youth of our nation, which is our greatest asset, then not only may some of these dreams that they have remain unfulfilled, but we may be facing a national crisis. We at Amity have endeavored to not be part of the problem, but part of the solution, and we have been active in a national dialogue to brainstorm what can be done to avert this national crisis. Experts say what is required is more interaction between industry and academia, more global expertise coming into India from different shores, a focus on skills and competencies driven by the demand from industry players like all of you, and fourthly, the utilization of technology to provide access to a much broader of students than what is available only through bricks and mortar that we have available in India today. And I'm so happy to note that the partnership that we have between RICS and Amity University touches upon each one of these points, where experts like yourselves from industry are helping in curriculum development, in the actual teaching of the programs, and also in writing case studies to improve the teaching pedagogy of the programs that we have. Mr. Anshuman Magazine himself has been to the Amity University a number of times to inspire the students and to talk to them about how to become better professionals in the framework that is set by RICS. My friend Samir Nair has also just walked in, who has also been to Amity University a number of times as part of this initiative. If I may say that with RICS as a successful model, at Amity we have also launched a number of other initiatives that are in partnership with industry. Today, there might be members of Tata Housing who are present here today. With one of your sister companies, Tata Technologies, we have created a joint venture institution, some say maybe for the first time in the history of the Tata Group, in which experts from the Tata Group, Tata Technologies, have come and built labs at Amity University, both in Noida and in Mumbai, and come and teach part of the programs. Here we are envisioning creating manpower for industrial engineering, for aerospace engineering, and automotive engineering at the highest level of engineering and design. Similarly, we have partnered with CII to create the CII School of Logistics at Amity University, addressing the manpower need in the very important areas of supply chain management and logistics. These are examples that have now come up after the very successful launch of RICS at Amity University, and we'll keep endeavoring to keep expanding our partnership with industry and taking forward the dialogue that can happen between institutions and experts like yourself who are committed to contributing towards creating manpower that can be utilized from day one in the companies and in policy making. As has been mentioned, the School of Built Environment in Noida has seen great success. In the first years itself, 100% placement at very competitive salaries, and almost a third of the students being called for job assignments outside of India. This is both a testament of the quality of manpower that we have in India. I always say that our Indian youth is second to none in terms of talent anywhere in the world, and also the standards that have been imbibed in them by RICS, making them so attractive to companies all over the world. And I'm sure that many of these students who have gone abroad after learning best practices from all over the world may come back to India at some point to become leaders in their own right in this sector. At the end of the day, it is people who create and drive an initiative. And I must here take a moment to thank our partners at RICS who have shown great vision and determination to work closely with the Amity University to make this a great success. We have Sachin Sandhir here, who has spent countless hours at the university to hammer out the details of how this would work. And then from the RICS India team, if I can mention a few names, Professor Katie Ravindran, Professor Anil Soni, Professor Sunil Agarwal, Dr. DTV Raghu, Ashwin Avasthi are all here who have been very active in the Noida initiative, and now we have Dr. Jagdish Mutt and Amol Shimpi, who are part of the Mumbai initiative. This is a truly wonderful team, and I applaud your dedication, your integrity, and your hard work from the RICS side to make this a reality. I must also address the Amity team, because they have been equal partners in taking this forward. And Dr. A.K. Srivastav, if I can request you to stand up for a moment. If you can give a hand to Dr. A.K. Srivastav. He has competency-based education in his blood, and he has been driving this initiative from our side, guided at Amity by Dr. Atul Chauhan in Noida and Ashish Bindra, our CFO, who have been working very hard to make this a reality. And in Mumbai, this would not be possible without the dedication of our team here. Dr. V.V. Kole is here. He was formerly the Vice Chancellor of the University of Mumbai and one of the most distinguished and recognized academicians in the state. When our university came up, he left that position where he had hundreds of thousands of students under him to come to a university which had zero students. And when I first had the discussion with him, I was nervous. I said, why would you leave such a big empire and come and join a university which is just starting? And he said, Dr. Chauhan, don't worry. Amity University will create a flag in Maharashtra which will be recognized as one of the best universities, not only in the state or in the country, but anywhere in the world. Dr. Kohli, we are so proud to have you at the helm of affairs at this university. And I know your commitment towards the School of Built Environment of RICS at your university. With Dr. Kohli, many of the HOIs are here. If I can just ask you to stand up and be recognized as the leaders of this university, Professor Shirodkar and the rest of the HOIs, Dr. Srivastav, can you please stand up for a moment? I want everyone to see the leaders of this university here in Mumbai. The Amity University in Mumbai is, of course, part of the larger Amity Education Group with 150,000 students across 30 campuses in India and 12 campuses in international markets, including London and Singapore, Dubai, Abu Dhabi, South Africa, Mauritius, Romania, China, and our recently acquired 170-acre campus in New York. I'm sure that the Amity University in Mumbai will also follow in the deep tradition of research and innovation of our other Amity universities all over the world, where more than 780 patents have been filed by our scientists and our faculty member, where more than 1,500 case studies have been written, where more than 10,000 research publications have been authored by our faculty and scientists, which are in Scopus indexed journals. And I'm sure that together with the experts from RICS, we can envision many more things that we can do together. Today we are launching competency-based degree programs, and I hear today that even as we launch today, already 200 students have come forward to be enrolled in this program in Mumbai itself. It is a mind-boggling level of interest before an institution is launched, and I think this is a sign of things to come in the future. But apart from these programs, I think there is much more that we can do in the future. Maybe joint research programs, maybe joint corporate training for the industry, and maybe incubation of ventures that will have an impact on this industry. And I may note here that Sachin mentioned the PropTech. On that panel, there is a company in which is an investee company of ours. Gautam Tiwari, are you here from Smart Physics? This is a company that we had invested in, and I am happy that they are also represented in today's panel. In closing, I would like to thank Amanda Clack, Dr. Sean Tompkins, and the global leadership of RICS for having recognized the potential of India. The fact that the only institution that has been established anywhere in the world by RICS is this institution in India shows the commitment of RICS to the nation, to the youth of our country, and their belief in the future that India will have a very important role to play in the world in times to come. From our side, we again reaffirm our commitment to this partnership, and I look forward to walking this journey with you and to discover new parts of how to have an impact in the world. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir. In fact, we appreciate this partnership with Amity University, bringing in skilled hands, working minds, ignited minds, who are not only just ready to address the challenges of the profession, but also of India and of the planet as a whole. And as we spoke about, we've seen the success in the School of Built Environment, Noida. We are now going to be translating this success here in the financial capital, Mumbai, with the launch of the School of Built Environment, RICS School of Built Environment here in Mumbai. So let's do it as per our Indian traditions and customs by lighting the ceremonial lamp. I would like to request all our distinguished dignitaries here on the dais to please light the lamp as we mark the auspicious inauguration of the SBE here in Mumbai. I would also like to request Professor K.T. Ravindran, the Dean of RICS SBE Noida, and also Professor Jagdish Mutt, the Dean RICS SBE Mumbai, to please join in.
Om Tat Purushaya Vidmahe Vakratundaya Dhimahi Tanno Ganti Prachodayatu
as per our Indian traditions and beliefs by invoking the blessings of the Almighty and the blessings of everyone present here. As you can see also, each wick which is being lit, it is being passed from one person to another. That represents the sharing of knowledge. All of us need to come together as we are talking about having a world of honesty, integrity, looking into the interest of our respective nations and of this world, coming together towards sharing of knowledge, imbibing of knowledge, and in the process, growing and evolving in our professions. And the RICS School of Built Environment here in the financial capital, Mumbai, is going to be further taking it forward. So thank you, gentlemen and the lady, and may we request you all now to please take your seats in the front row. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have just had, as I said, the inauguration of the RICS School of Built Environment here in Mumbai, in a very auspicious manner, in our Indian, as per the Indian traditions and customs. We are going to be now taking it forward here in Mumbai with the same sense of service, enthusiasm, vigor, excitement. So let's have a look at how this campus is going to be shaping up and how we further take it here in Mumbai through this small video.
The RICS School of Built Environment, I feel that not only will provide talent to India itself, but it will provide talent to Asia Pac and the globe as the years pass by, because we as India, we do have a young population, very talented and ambitious. They want to do more, and I really feel it will have a huge impact on the Indian real estate market, but also Asia Pac and globally. And that's what I will be very excited about, that when the young Indian talent can contribute beyond Indian shores and make a global impact.
I think once you have a stamp, people know what they're getting. Look, if I hire someone, first of all, it's a risk. I don't know whether he's going to perform. I don't know whether he's going to be just a waste of time. But when you have some sort of validation, you're willing to actually put something on the line and say, okay, I know this guy's from RICS, or I know he's from so-and-so real estate school. And therefore, I can say, yes, I'm willing to take a punt on this. I'll take the guy. I'm willing to put out a fixed salary. and I know that I will get X, Y, Z return. I think once you do have a qualification, obviously you can expect a better remuneration from there.
Today, Jones Lang LaSalle in India, we employ close to 8,000 people in India, spread over 10 of our offices. All the time we are looking for people. In a year, we hire 1,000 to 1,500 people. And we believe there is a big demand for qualified professionals in real estate.
RSCS School of Built Environment, in my opinion, will definitely become a major source of attracting talent into the industry.
We believe because we don't find the visibility of any other such specialized institutes coming up. So more and more people should start coming out of this institute, and it will provide more visibility.
There's a huge shortage of talent. You know, when I say huge shortage of talents, you know, the talent requirement will be 100 times what is available today. So I'm talking about huge in that context, maybe 1,000 times what it is today. So for sure, institutions which are putting out qualified talent to help real estate becoming more professional, or most of the talent will get absorbed very rapidly the moment they, you know, finish the call, because there's a big shortage of qualified professionals joining this business.
Yes, we would look to hire. I joined this industry in India about 12 years back. There were hardly any people who understood real estate, hardly any people who understood finance. It's changed a lot since then. People look to hire people who've had the education or the experience in real estate. It's not that simple as it was about 12 years back. So yes, I would look to hire people.
We can tell the difference, because earlier we would have to invest in training, and today we're getting trained professionals coming through the door. So I think in next 5 years, you will see multifold growth, not just in percentage, but multifold growth from RSCS and institutes in our sector.
JLL works a lot with RICS globally for RICS accredited professionals. In India, JLL hires again from the RICS School of Environment.
We've hired a lot of students from the RICS Built Environment School, and we've been extremely happy. Thus far in India, there was no education for real estate, so I'm very happy that RICS has been able to provide. I would really like to see RICS be a hub, not just in Noida, but in other parts of the country as well.
Well, there is no other hub. I think they're the only game in town today, and they've done a fabulous job in the last few years. I remember when we were discussing actually setting up a school, I was very skeptical. I thought it would take 5, 7, 8 years, but in no time, the team just had everything on the ball and moved forward.
And ladies and gentlemen, it's a school which is not only extending the skills and the talent, but the right kind of attitude to the people here to be in this profession. And so many people, in fact, voicing it, extending confidence in the school. Thank you. Now, from our earlier speakers, you did hear the name of the Honorable Minister for Railway, Shri Suresh Prabhu. He's not present with us, but yes, he's going to be present with us and sharing his views through a video recording. In fact, he wanted to be with us, but due to pressing engagement and earlier engagement, he could not make it. He has sent across his video recording. And I think it becomes very imperative again for all of us to listen to his views and through his strong mentoring and guidance. For he is someone who's hailed as a transformist and a reformist. The kind of reforms which he has been able to bring in the energy sector, and now the new concepts and ideas which he is coming in, bringing in the railway sector, completely revolutionizing the Indian railways. He has been an evangelist for technology, for power, for energy, for infrastructure, for transport, all of this which is going to be impacting our world of real estate. So we hear his views and further his guidance through this video recording. Shri Suresh Prabhu, the Honorable Minister for Railways. So we thank the Honorable Minister in absentia as he spoke about these new developments, new India shaping up. That is where a new thinking is definitely required, and RICS is going to be playing a very important role. He complimented the work which RICS, School of Built Environments, are also doing towards shaping this new thinking, new India. And ladies and gentlemen, as we come almost at the end, before we thank our respected speakers, distinguished speakers who addressed us all and set the tone and the context of our discussions and present them the mementos, I would like to invite here Mr. Anshuman Magazine, the Chairman RICS South Asia Board, and the Chairman India and Southeast Asia CBRE for his concluding remarks and also to propose a vote of thanks.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'll be quite short, as it has been quite a long inaugural. What is interesting is that this is one of the few or the only place I've been to where Donald Trump's name has not been taken for the last 2 hours, you know. And why is it important? We were doing a review for our business in Southeast Asia for 2017, and our head of Singapore business said, look, my numbers have to come down because Donald Trump has just won elections, and he may change the global trade, and we don't know what will happen to the business. But I think our Prime Minister went a step ahead, and I can't help but talk about the demonetization of this currency. I think this is an extremely positive move. It's going to be a seismic shift in how at least real estate works, besides the whole economy. There will be short-term pain. Everybody sitting here has lost out. Our net worth is less than it was before this was announced, because anybody who owns an apartment, the values would have come down. So we all are a victim. But the fact is, this will be really positive in the long term. I completely support what the Prime Minister did. It will have certain impacts, like one of the concerns, and people don't talk about the concerns. It's not only people short-term getting in those queues and don't have cash to spend, but there would be a short-term impact on our industry. One of the concerns I have is that the construction may slow down because there is a lot of cash which gets, the way this construction industry works, the labor gets paid, there's a lot of cash circulation, and it may slow down construction projects, high-end retail. Interestingly, someone mentioned to me in Delhi, in one luxury store, that night itself, there was a sale of 18 crores for just one product because people are just trying to, get rid of their cash. That's a huge amount. The fact is also for next few months, I don't think that store will have any sales. So they should be happy they made up for next few months. Of course, residential, sector, at least at the high end, may suffer in the short term, and also investments going in. But the fact is, I feel this is all worth it, because in the long term, this will bring in huge amount of institutional investor. This, along with real estate, the RERA Regulatory Act coming in, with REIT, with GST, everything else what is happening is really going to take our economy to the next level. It'll be really positive, and I'm really optimistic. And after the initial pain, and like I said, nobody escaped that pain. But in next 6, 9, 12 months' time and onwards, our real estate economy, the built environment, the Indian economy will be at another level. And imagine, environment where there is transparency, anybody investing, because I have not in my lifetime, I had not thought in India these things will happen. I never thought there'll be a regulator. I never thought there'll be limited cash transactions in real estate, because it was just way of life, and this is going to change, and it's going to change for the better. Not only we have to adapt to this, we also have to adapt to technology. We are a young country, as we all know. That 60% of India is under the age of 35. We have one of the largest millennial population in the world, and we do need to take into account that what environment that we give them going forward. If these young generation, if they have to really be productive contribute to the country? Do we want to give the same environment to them, the environment we worked in for so many years? For them to prosper, for our country to prosper, we have to make sure the millennials coming into the economic environment, coming to the job market, do get a level playing field, do get a transparent way of working. And a lot of the steps which has been taken by the government and a lot of the steps which has been taken previously in a few years will one day make India a place where we could compete in the world, we could really have a level playing field, we could work like any international mature economy works. And it seems, all of this seems that, you know, this may not happen. But like I said, I never thought in my lifetime whatever is happening will ever happen. So I'm quite, again, optimistic things will improve. Again, talking to the millennials, I think this will be the most important area which sometimes gets neglected, that the millennial demography will be game changer for our sector also. You know, the way the young people live, the way they work, you know, how do they, you know, how do we redefine the workplace from design point of view? There's so many changes which we're seeing. E-commerce, there is, like I said, a seismic shift the way India is going to work, forget the world for the time being. How our real estate economy is going to work in next 4 to 5 years, if we are here discussing real estate, built environment or economy, it'll be another world. And it'll happen sooner than we think. So it is, these are exciting times. Skill shortage was mentioned, and I believe RSA has played a big role as being the first institution to really look at professional real estate degrees. So RICS International, the local team under the leadership of Sachin, then collaboration with Amity. I mean, that itself was a game changer because we were struggling for quite some time how to establish. And I think with RICS, with Amity University, it's been fantastic. A lot of what is achieved is thanks to their collaboration. Otherwise, knowing the Indian bureaucracy and the challenges, we would not be talking about 1,500 students who are there, people who have come out with degrees, and we're talking about now opening in Mumbai and one day in Bangalore. So that collaboration has been really important. It is what, you know, can you imagine, a few years back, we did not have a single professional degree or course in India in real estate. And today we're moving at this part. So all put together, you know, today when we talk about this Amity and RICS built environment being opened in Mumbai, it's a big step. I used to get calls from other cities saying that, look, when is RICS going to open in Bangalore, for example, or even Chennai in Hyderabad? And I'm sure one day that will happen. But this itself is a game changer, and we'll imagine skills, so many people coming to the industry. This itself will bring professionalism. We always talk about professionalism in every sector. And real estate was the last sector, I think, everybody in India felt, you know, if you're not professionally qualified, you know, you can get to the real estate industry. That's not the case anymore, not only because of all the degrees and education, it's just how the environment has changed. I just want to conclude by saying that we all come to these conferences. There's a huge effort which goes on behind to make this a success. So first of all, most important, we could not have done this without the sponsors. So I'd like to thank the sponsors and for today's conference. This is Tata Housing, PNB Housing Finance, and Colliers International. I would also like to thank all the speakers, panelists, guests who came here today. Again, like someone mentioned, it's a holiday, and all the audience who made an effort to come here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we are concluding this inaugural session on a very positive and optimistic note. The industry welcoming the demonetization. And yes, as mentioned, there are going to be some pains, but for the long-term gains, these pains are, of course, also welcomed. The RICS School of Built Environment further preparing itself to address all these challenges which we have already spoken, and we are going to be discussing them in detail in our our session. So thanking once again all the speakers for setting the tone and the context. And as a token of our appreciation and gratitude, we would like to present a memento. I would like to invite here Mr. Anshuman Magazine to please join me here as we thank speakers. And as I invite once again the speakers, requesting them to please join us here to accept this token of gratitude. So first, thanking and our esteemed thanks goes to Ms. Amanda Clack. Please, ma'am, thank you once again. A special one, the Lady Luck. Yeah. Thank you so much. And now inviting here Dr. Sean Tompkins. Our appreciation and gratitude to Dr. Aseem Chauhan. And would like to now request Mr. Sachin Sandhi to kindly present the memento thanking Mr. Anshuman Magazine. So this is from him to you. So thank you once again. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, also for being with us.